Hello, everybody, and welcome back to our third panel of today's discussions. I'm glad to see that you're still here, because after all this political and geostrategic talking, now we really want to talk about the human side, the humanitarian aspects of this terrific crisis in Syria. We'll talk about refugees, and whereas the Syrian crisis as a whole hardly makes it into the headlines of our newspapers, the refugees do, at least whenever several hundreds of them drown in the Mediterranean Sea. So we have been busy with this subject for weeks and months, trying to find solutions on a national, international, European level. Among the refugees that make their way over the Mediterranean, the Syrians are now the fourth biggest group, and 2,157 Syrians have drowned since 2011 in the Mediterranean. Syria, that's the biggest humanitarian catastrophe of our days. Half of the population, which used to be 22 million, are displaced. Just imagine, half the population of a country is on the run, aiming for protection somehow. 6.5 million at least are displaced inside the country, changing their homes, trying to seek help with relatives, family, with whoever can give them shelter. And 4 million Syrians have left the country, the majority of them to the neighboring countries, Lebanon, Jordan, Turkey, Kurdistan, Iraq, and to some extent Egypt as well. How these people are and what we can do for them or should do for them. This is our subject here on our panel. We will discuss it among us at the beginning, and then we will open the panel as well as we did before towards you, and we are ready to hear your questions. And I would like to welcome my four guests. Hans Stenfeld, to my left, is the representative of the UNHCR in Germany. In Germany, the United Nations High Commissioner of Refugees here in Berlin. He has been working with the UNHCR for 30 years in different countries, from Zambia, Cambodia, India, Myanmar, New Zealand. This is a very global perspective on the refugee subject. Thanks for being with us. To my left is Dr. Christian Kloos. He is the head of the unit Immigration Law in the Federal Ministry of the Interior. Very important to have him here because he deals with all the important and sensitive issues like residency, visa procedures, humanitarian admission, family reunifications, and the Bundesprogramme, the programs that we have here in Germany to allocate or to invite Syrian refugees to come here. Thank you for being with us. To my right, we have George Rali from the NGO Aleph, Act for Human Rights. Oops, sorry. He came to us from Lebanon. And Aleph is campaigning for human rights issues. It's campaigning against arbitrary detention, against torture. And you have, which is very important, you have a monitoring unit for Syrian refugees in Lebanon, in Beirut. So we'll be curious to hear more about that. Thank you for being with us. And Gabriele Del Grande, my colleague from Italy. He's a well-known Italian journalist, author, and blogger. And he is probably one of the most influential activists in human rights with concern to migration policy in Europe, because you have been blogging since 2006 on the subject, and you keep on telling us the personal stories behind the very many illegal immigrants that come to Europe. So it's very important to see what you have done research about. And you just co-authored and co-directed a documentary film called Lo sto con la sposa, auf der Seite der Braut, on the side of the bride, where you smuggle a bunch of Syrians that are they pretend to be a wedding ceremony, from Italy to Sweden, I think. So this would be interesting, why you need to pretend to be marrying to get from Italy to Sweden. I would like to, as we don't have any Syrian refugee here among us, I would like to give my voice to a Syrian refugee who told a colleague of mine in Lebanon, we pray every day to God that he would send us an earthquake. Then we would have help tomorrow. but we only have a war. So my first question goes to Mr. Tanfeld. I think the program concerning Syria is the biggest rescue program in the history of the UNHCR, but still it's not completely financed. I think you need for this year $4.5 billion for 2015. Until now you have reached 20%. So how come, how is it that it's so difficult to get the international community to pay at least for the UNHCR, which would be a very common agency to deal with this problem?
Sorry, this will help. Maybe I should clarify. I mean, the amount that you're talking about is not just for our own, for UNHCR's program, but it's to finance the activities of all the all the UN agencies and other agencies active there. But indeed, until now, we have only about 20 to 23% of the money that we need, that we estimate that we need funded, received in terms of funding. It may sound strange, but it's still in line with the funding we've had the last few years as well. But the disappointing situation therefore is that at the end of 2013, at the end of 2014, we had only 50% of the funding that we really, really required. And it looks like we're heading that same direction again this year. And it just means that because this is a global situation, this applies to certainly for UNHCR, for all our programs. There's the humanitarian assistance is coming to an end. We have never yet raised so many funds, whether for Syria or for other emergency crises or for other refugee situations. But the number of refugees, as you know, worldwide are more than 50 million. So the demand and the needs have increased. And that's where we do say, on the one hand, we need more humanitarian assistance, but we are increasingly also saying there needs to be more development assistance coming in. And Lebanon is a prime example where this would be needed, because it's with 1 million inhabitants, 1 million refugees, and more than 4 million inhabitants. There's an extraordinary demand on just the regular infrastructure in Lebanon.
Talking about Lebanon, I mean, there is a lot of solidarity within the region with the Syrians. We have to admit this. But as he just mentioned, Lebanon is really paying somehow a high price as well for this generosity on one side and for the dealing with the refugees, which is to be disputed probably from your point of view. Can you just give us an overview, how are Syrian refugees in Lebanon? What's their daily life like? What's their problems? And what does this major influx of refugees make, or what does it do to the host community in Lebanon, to the country?
Well, us Lebanese would always like to present things happening in Lebanon as being exceptional. And the Syrian refugee crisis in Lebanon is also no exception to this exception. What's happening is that, well, there is around one-third of the Lebanese population is actually Syrian refugees, living in a country where the government already fails to provide basic services for its citizens, which increases, as such, the resentment of the Lebanese citizens regarding, well, refugees receiving assistance, while at the same time Lebanese off the tracks regarding that. Well, the day-to-day life of Syrians getting more and more desperate, more and more miserable on a day-to-day basis. The Lebanese government tends to propose and adopt policies on an ad hoc basis that are often counterproductive to the aims of the Lebanese government, but also restricting more and more the life of refugees and making it more and more difficult.
Making it difficult to enter the country in the first place, and to stay there?
Well, basically, regulations cover the whole aspect, from the access to territory, which basically the Lebanese government corroborated on violations in that regard, that the Lebanese government will not allow refugees to access the territory, and this is an open, clear policy by the Lebanese government, which is violating the basic principles of human rights and refugee protection. We add to that the freedom of movement of refugees inside the country and the access to basic services and assistance, whether by UN agencies or others, which makes refugees at stake of, well, basically failing to receive assistance. That's one major issue. Always at risk of arbitrary detention, of administrative detention in that regard, and basically also resentment and harassment by Lebanese citizens.
Comparing the numbers, only the numbers, comparing their numbers in the region with the one in Europe is somehow a little bit shameful, because where we have 1.2 million officially registered, in Lebanon it's probably almost 2 million refugees, we have 2,054,000 Syrians who have seeking asylum in the whole of Europe, out of which 52% are in Germany and Sweden. So this is a good news for Germany, that at least Germany is kind of generous towards the Syrian refugees. But still, I would like to ask you, Mr. Kloos, it's a little bit paradox, because any Syrian who makes it to Germany gets usually asylum quite quickly. He gets a 2-year residency, but there is not a lot of possibilities to come here in a legal way. So somehow we don't care how they make it to Germany. Once they are here, they get the 2 years, they get the asylum. But with this policy, we kind of push the Syrians into this illegal migration that at the same time we don't really want it. So what's the solution for that? Why don't we have more national programs? Why don't we have better legal ways to reach Europe, instead of leaving it up to the refugees, spending all their savings on their way and arriving here without anything, with a big trauma, and facing a lot of difficulties to make up with their story of seeking refuge in the first place? Why is there not more initiative to help Syrians come here legally?
Thanks for giving the opportunity to answer a complex question. I tried within one sentence. Admission is not the solution, and it's not the primary objective of the federal government in this refugee crisis. The issue is which kind of solution. You mentioned the word solution in this context, and I appreciate the holistic view of this conference on this particular subject. However, this is just an effect of the war that we face, and the tremendous numbers have just been mentioned. 9.5 million, I mean, half of the Syrian population is on the move, and two-thirds IDPs, internally displaced persons, 3.5 million out of Syria. In particular, of course, in the neighboring countries. So what is the solution? I mean, the primary objective of the federal government is to support the international community, the international organizations. Germany is a major donor for UNHCR and its efforts in the region. Here, it's always a question of resources. And I have to be frank on this particular issue. We clearly see a need to really for dealing. I mean, we have just been I've been in the region several times, and since the refugee flows do not diminish, UNHCR is still in kind of emergency mode, just to provide food and shelter for nearly uncountable refugees. So this is a tremendous effort. This is the challenge which has to be faced. And it's always a question of regionalization of refugee flows. This is our primary refugee policy, or primary tool in such crisis. And all other elements are just complementary to what we do actually in the region. With regard to my ministry, we have also the humanitarian relief agency on the spot, the TAW, Technisches Hilfswerk, and trying to provide the so-called wash installations, sanitation, and so on and so forth in the refugee camps. So if you want to address really the in a horizontal way most of the refugees and giving them a possibility to survive in a peaceful environment, then we have to do it there. I do not question at all the added value of all what we do with regard to admission, but it has to be clear that solutions have to be found, political solutions have to be found. As long as the refugee crisis is there, we have to strengthen and we have to further continue our efforts in the region, in particular, to really address those countless refugees there. And of course, we do a lot on admission, and as a matter of fact, with Germany 2 years ago, who got into a kind of initiative and installed a federal admission program for Syrian refugees. And this was always addressed at EU level to actually stimulate an EU admission program, and we are not naive on this particular subject, to ease the burden of the neighboring countries, because in mere numbers, also from the logistical challenge behind 2 years ago when we developed the program with UNHCR, it was never meant and it was never intended to have a real quantitative ease of burden for the countries concerned, but it's a qualitative ease of burden, in particular for the international organizations on the spot where particular needs are, where particularly vulnerable people cannot continue to live in these surroundings as we have it in Lebanon, the tented settlements. So taking these people out makes a qualitative difference. But for the time being, we have not yet received the European response as we have hoped for.
But talking about Germany, I think we have had three contingents, right, from these federal admission programs. And it's a total number of, I think, 15,000 or 19,000, you mentioned to me. It was 5,000 plus 5,000 plus
10,000.
10,000.
And we are nearly finished with that 20,000. Federal admission program.
But in the 1990s, when I remember well, we took in 300,000 people from Bosnia. Why was it at that time possible to be just a lot more generous? And I miss a little bit the political will behind this.
It's a bit bizarre because we have national debates in Germany on this particular subject. It's always said that there's a lack of generosity, and this is addressed to the federal government. As a matter of fact, for these primary measures, we have spent about 1 billion euro so far to stem the refugee flows and to cover this humanitarian crisis. And we have had 30,000 Syrian nationals residing in Germany before the crisis. We are now approximately 140,000 Syrians here. This means 110,000 Syrian nationals have found refuge in Germany. So Germany is the main country of reception for Syrian refugees outside the region. And therefore, I'm thankful that you acknowledge it. The issue is that the point is that we have to promote it and to direct this plea to others to share our particular will to help these people. And during the UNHCR pledging conference last December, we have repeated that we would go beyond the 20,000 under the federal program if other European partners would follow us. I'm pleased to hear that, for example, well, this was not the EU, but at least European states, Switzerland has now announced 3,000 places for Syrian refugees. And I think we are progressing in our efforts to invite other European partners to do the same efforts what we do.
That's true, and that brings us to the European question, which is even more shameful than if we look at the German generosity that is there in the end. We have some laws, European laws, that make life quite difficult for refugees who reach Europe, because whenever they reach Europe finally, their problems are not over. Gabriele De Grande, you know a lot about the realities of refugees in Syria, especially the ones that reach Greece and Italy. How come that you have to smuggle them from Italy to Sweden? What's the problem inside Europe once they reach Europe?
Well, actually, it happened it was something very spontaneous that happened. I was in Syria 5 times as a journalist, and if I'm still here, it is thanks to Syrian people and Syrian friends who saved my life when I was in Syria. And so when it happened that we met in Milano some Syrian friends who escaped from the war, we were not able to make the visa in the embassy, because this is the problem, the visa. I mean, that 2,000 Syrians who died in the sea and the 20,000 people who have died in the sea in the last years, they died because they were not able to get a visa in the embassy. And this is the main problem. But concerning our Syrian friends, when it was not possible to make the visa, they decided to come by boat. When we met them in Milano, it was natural. I mean, they were friends. Their aim was to reach Sweden, and we hosted them at our place, in our houses, as you do with some friends, and we decided to bring them to Sweden. Then we discovered that it was illegal. Then we discovered that today in Europe, to help war refugees, sometimes it can bring you to the prison. We made a film about
that. It makes you a smuggler.
We are still risking to be sentenced as smugglers. I think that really there are some paradox, you know, when you think about that. Then if you want me to be more technical, the problem is about Dublin Convention. I mean, we have some rules which has more to see with the bureaucracy and national interest than the pragmatic solution of the problem, which forbid people, to asylum seekers, to move inside Europe. I mean, you have to stay in the first country that catch you. I mean, Europe has made some rules about visa, some regulations that made almost impossible for people, not from all around the world. I mean, we made also agreement of a freedom of movement with the Balkans, with the Eastern Europe, some countries of South America. But Africa and war countries, we don't like that. So I can tell you for direct experience, I have some friends in Syria, we did all the possible, it was impossible to get a visa. So we forbid them to travel when they do the only thing they can. They go knocking at the door of the smugglers in Libya, in Turkey, and they pay thousands of euro. Imagine you, apart from the death, but if you manage to arrive, imagine how your destiny change if you came here with a flight, 100 euro per ticket, or for a family, for example, if you pay 20,000 euro. And you arrive in Italy, you have no money with you, and you have to call your family again and make them send you another money, because from Italy to Sweden or to Germany, you have to be smuggled again. In Milano is a European center for smugglers now. I mean, last year at least 50,000 Syrians were smuggled between Italy and Germany or Sweden. There is also a political decision of Italy. You know, every country in Europe, they have the same kind of words. They say they are too much for us. No, we are already too much generous, so the other state have to do their take their responsibilities. So Italy, what is doing? They're not taking the fingerprints, because if as an asylum seeker you arrive in Germany, you apply for asylum, you are sent back to Italy if your fingerprints are registered. So in this moment, the Italian government decided not to take the fingerprints. It is unofficial; it's not official, but I think it's. What they are using to negotiate more funds, more money for the patrolling, because at the very end, the only solution, the only approach that we are able to imagine, it is a military approach. And this I also invite you to think about that. I mean, there is a war in a neighboring country. Syria is a Mediterranean country. Maybe from Germany it looks a bit far, but from Italy it's like a neighboring country. I mean, I don't know. Me, I was told that when the house of your neighbor burns, you open the door first, and then you see how to deal with that. I mean, we have thousands of people who are trying to come, thousands who are dying, and we are not able to imagine just a simplification of the rules about visa. I mean, why is not possible for a Syrian who wants to come to Europe to get a visa in an embassy? Is the only way, give them a legal alternative in order not to make them die in the sea. And then, you know, every time that there is a shipwreck with 800 people who died, we say, okay, we cry a little bit. We say, okay, we should find a solution. And the only solution is a military operation in Libya.
Yes, thank you, Gabriele. I mean, let's just share these questions with our politicians on the panel. Why is it, or wouldn't it be time to change Dublin? Because it's just not the way to deal with refugees anymore. We've seen that this policy has failed. The only thing that the European Union could agree on now, facing all these people drowning in the Mediterranean, was this military solution, is to destroy smuggler boats in front of the coast of Libya. But whenever it comes to discussing, you know, to share the burden of the different refugees, every nation state says, no, we have already taken in too much. So what would be a different policy? You once wrote your Doktorarbeit, your doctoral thesis, about options of European migrant policy. So what is one of these options? Don't we have to change something about this?
Always. I mean, I'm not a politician, but I'm a civil servant. I'm bound by law in what we do. And this is actually what we do. And I think what we shouldn't do in this context, or we should possibly separate the discussions. There's one, the Syria refugee crisis, and where we have found different answers to the questions. And in this context, of course, it plays a role. Can refugees apply for a visa at the embassies? Then it's always the question, what's the legal basis for this particular request? If it is just a visit visa, these visas had to be rejected to the Schengen law, because it was absolutely clear that the refugees wouldn't return to the country. So if you would like to open up admission to Syrian refugees, the method, the technical method to do this is like Germany does, to set up admission programs. And actually, and that's the key here, to establish, and we have had very intensive discussions with the UNHCR on how to address this issue, and because numbers, it would never be enough. You know, we have announced in our initial contingent 5,000 places. So how to identify out of 100,000 5,000 people? So we needed to identify criteria to privilege certain refugees over others. And if you go into the region, you have clearly the impression that all these people need help, and this is true. But the question is, if you have limited space, limited resources, who would you prefer over another refugee? And this is not an easy task to do. We have found different criteria where we thought that this is very sensitive response here, and where we can also, in the margins of, or in the context of the results of the UNHCR, justify such an admission program, because it was not always welcome for the neighboring countries to install such an admission program. If you believe that all neighboring countries were in favor of such admission programs, then you are wrong. There have been countries where they were not particularly in favor to install an admission program, because we have, as I said, many internally displaced persons, and if you set up admission programs for a limited number, then this might cause a pull effect for the neighboring country concerned. So if we take out 5,000, they might face 50,000 IDPs coming. So it's not that easy just to bring in place an admission country, even if it is done or intended with the best will. Admission, even if you install admission programs, this has to be done sensitive, because one thing is clear, you will never have enough places for all refugees wanting to leave this camp situation, or even if you are not in a camp. The colleagues do know the situation, in particular in Lebanon. From very poor circumstances, without perspective, to a European country where fairly normal life can continue. So this is the challenge with regard to the Syrian refugees. So I could also make a monologue on the Mediterranean situation, but here we have to see this is also a long-term challenge which we face, and this does not only concern the Syrian refugee crisis. Here we have to go much more in depth on all refugee situations. And although I'm in a Syria conference, I should stress, as Mr. Tenfeld said, we have 50 million refugees, and with among the refugee communities in other countries, there's even the fear that there is some sort of cannibalization among refugee flows or among refugee populations. And if it comes to resettlement, and we will have next month then the yearly resettlement conference in Geneva, there is indeed a fear that the wide acceptance, and this is in particular true also for Germany, that here the Syrian refugees receive a lot of warm welcome. There have been fears expressed that this a bit, as I said, cannibalizing among other refugee flows. So we have to address then a lot of issues, not only the question of logistical transport, which are now performed by smugglers and human beings.
What seems to be very important then is the criteria that we use to choose the refugees to resettle in Europe. And I remember the Lebanese foreign minister saying that Germany, or he was at least, yeah, he was kind of making this allegation, that Germany would choose the preferably the Christians and the well-educated among the Syrian refugees, which causes a lot of problems for Lebanon again. You're probably familiar with this allegation.
Well, basically, countries of first asylum don't have much the choice on who to welcome and not who to welcome. But this is not really... I want just to give an answer on how maybe to stop smuggling or how to help refugees that are coming to Europe is actually by making the situation where they are better. Whether for Lebanon, actually, to make the solution in Syria actually much better. We speak about durable solutions to the refugee crisis. You're not just speaking about solving bits and pieces of the situation. For Europe, basically, well, in my opinion, Western government and the EU should not tolerate restrictive policies by the Lebanese government, because when you make the situation of Syrian refugees in Lebanon unable to get residency permit, unable to go to work, unable to go to school, and unable to have access to healthcare, they will join those death boats and go to Europe. And the European countries keep on tolerating. Well, it's been since January that the Lebanese government has been adopting these policies. And so far, we haven't seen any Western government, and EU in particular, that is addressing that. That's the same, for example, for Lebanon in not playing a role in actually finding solutions in general. In our opinion, is the more we delay discussions on solutions, whether in Europe or in Lebanon or in Jordan or in Iraq, the more these solutions are going to be impossible to adopt and impossible to implement. If you want to take the example of Thailand and the boat people crisis, we've seen that, well, basically Thailand have agreed on a plan 30 years after the refugees or 20 years after the refugees have been settled. And we noticed that these plans are actually no way to be implemented. That's the same for Lebanon. Lebanon has adopted a policy in October 2014. However, the policy has been drafted in 2012 when there were only 60,000 refugees in Lebanon. And, well, basically, Lebanon is implementing on full force these policies that are actually no longer contextual. We're speaking about 60,000. Now we're speaking about 1.5 million. We're speaking about conflicts in Syria that are... located in particular geographic areas. Now we speak about a widespread civil war. So in my opinion, we should not encourage governments in adopting restrictive policies in general. And this could be the first step to start elaborating solutions that can be comprehensive, overarching different issues, and not just looking about the Mediterranean or Greece or temporary protection directives or Dublin II that are very limited in scope, in time and geography.
So let's go back a little bit to the situation inside Syria that we haven't really talked about until now. The problem, we'll get back to this criteria point maybe later on.
Yeah, but not that somebody leaves the room and believes that we have admission programs for Christians, which is actually absolutely not the case. And we have, this is a very sensitive issue if you work in this area or in this region, and this, with this cultural and religious background, you cannot come there and ask to get out Christians, particularly not out of Lebanon, with a very, interesting internal political structure. This is absolute no-go. So we have
there,
clearly...
There high share actually among the refugees.
This is not the case. The vast majority of the refugees under the federal admission programs are of Sunni belief. The Christian share is absolute average to the share of the Syrian population, and therefore there is no not active, not passive privilegiation of Christians within this federal admission program.
Of high education level?
Well, here I have to mention that we have 30,000 people living in Germany and before the crisis, and this diaspora was or is indeed well-educated, well-integrated into German society. And we have allowed under the various programs, we not only have the federal admission program, we have also have federal programs by the Bundesländer, the federal states, here in Germany, another approximately 14,000 by now who came over this program. And we have allowed, of course, relatives to invite, and it's not family reunification, this is another issue, I'll just come to this in a moment, but we have also made it possible that relatives could invite relatives here to Germany. So it's just a prolongation or perpetuation of the diaspora we already had in Germany. And I mean, and I just mentioned what is the good reason to privilege or to give to grant refuge in Germany, and one is family ties. And this is simply representing the Syrian population which has lived in Germany before.
Maybe just neatly start. I mean, it's needless to say that, of course, for UNHCR in the selection of refugees that are to be resettled, ethnicity doesn't play a role. For us, it's the need for protection, and it's the vulnerability of the person. So the ones that were selected by us under these programs, for instance, I mean, altogether, I think 6,000 were submitted by UNHCR. Those were the criteria. What for us is very important as well is indeed the family reunification, maintaining the family unity. That's important in resettlement. That's now also very important within Europe, and we're talking about Dublin and the Dublin system that is not working as it should. Dublin 3 does put an emphasis on the family unity and the possibility for family members to join, and that we very much welcome. But it's also clear that the whole European asylum system, the framework is there, but it's not functioning. It needs to be addressed, and it needs to be addressed sooner rather than later.
The UNHCR is providing assistance for refugees inside Syria as well, but mainly in the regions that are still under the control of Bashar al-Assad. We have had a UN resolution last year saying that there has to be humanitarian access to all parts of Syria. It has not been implemented until now. We have a lot of regions, especially the ones that have fallen out of regime control, that are not being reached with the necessary help. And we have just seen pictures from Jisr al-Shurur, where we found packages, UNHCR assistance packages with the Syrian army that were left there. So it seems that Bashar al-Assad is using this humanitarian help for his own political purposes as well. He is giving them to the army rather than giving it to the civilian people that they were supposed to reach. What can the UNHCR do about that?
Well, let me first clarify. It's not only UNHCR working there, and especially in a situation within a country like Syria, where we're talking about internally displaced persons. It's UNHCR is part of the overall UN system that is providing assistance. But it's clear that we cannot provide assistance without working and with the government, but also with, if there are areas that are not controlled by the government, then with the parties that control those areas. And that's where we basically find that we don't have access to, I think the estimate is to 4 or 5 million Syrians, for reasons of access, for reasons of security. It's a very difficult situation in which we are working there, and where we are trying to reach the ones that do need the assistance.
Although there is, I think, cross-border action now is allowed. I mean, this UN resolution last year allowed this, right?
Cross-border,
why is it not taking place?
That's a good question. I'm not sure it's all a matter of security being in place and of being sure that indeed, or as sure as possible, that the assistance that would go in with a convoy indeed reaches the destination and does not get diverted. Those are issues that are very important to us. If we don't have those assurances, it becomes very difficult for us to try and give that, you know, bring in that assistance.
Given the fact that this crisis will probably go on for another maybe 10 years, don't we need a much bigger and long-term attempt? You know, I think the time of emergency help should be over. We should really think about an international strategy to address especially the subject of Syrian children and young people not going to school, for example. I mean, it can't be that in all the neighboring countries, it's private initiatives, nice people from the village, private schools who open up, NGOs who come around and say, oh, yes, there is a teacher for 300 more Syrian children. Don't we need a lot bigger approach towards this crisis? Do we need maybe some kind of a new UNRWA that was set up for the Palestinian refugees 50 years ago or more? Don't we need maybe a UN agency like this to deal with this major refugee crisis that will keep us busy for the next 10 years or more?
I'm not sure creating yet another UN agency is the solution. What rather needs to happen, and I mean we've taken steps here in Berlin in December. The UN proposed a plan for both for Syria itself and for the neighboring countries, which does not only address the humanitarian assistance but also the longer term assistance that is required, so the resilience part, as we call it. UNDP, the UN Development Program, is also part of that whole package, if you like, because indeed we don't see any political solution in the near future, unfortunately. So we do need to think of how can we help the refugees, but how can we also help the host communities? And that's where supporting a country like Lebanon, which is a middle income country, it doesn't normally qualify for development aid, but considering the situation, it needs those criteria for when development aid goes in or when aid from the World Bank goes in, needs to be changed so that a country like Lebanon or also Jordan can be assisted also in their host communities. Their infrastructure can be supported. But I don't think creating yet another UN agency would be the solution. It's just more assistance needed, humanitarian assistance, and especially also development assistance.
Do you have other ideas or demands? I mean, why don't the Syrian children in Lebanon don't just join Lebanese schools? Why don't they just, I mean, with the money of the international community, help them join? There's no problem with language, opposite to Turkey, for example, but in Jordan and Lebanon, it would be easy to just integrate them somehow in the school system. Why isn't this happening?
Well, maybe that's the first time I can agree with UNHCR, but but the regime is in place. There is no need to create a new regime for refugees. The regime is in place, but I think everybody should play a role. And in my opinion, we should go beyond the UN Convention. It's not just the responsibility of the West, I'm sorry to say, but also countries beyond the West should take responsibility. Arab countries in the first place, we can say.
Arab and not neighboring countries. You mean the Gulf countries?
Well, no. Even Lebanon has to play a role, because forbidding children to go to school is not just, it's part of the obligations. Basically, there's no logical explanation why children cannot go to school or why they cannot access hospitals. Basically, somebody will eventually pay for that. And the responsibility and the burden sharing, and in quotation burden sharing, is beyond actually giving money. It's not just acceptance. It's not just admissions, family reunification. But it should be also the pressure to make sure that the pressure and the policies that should put in, be put in place in order to provide the best for the refugees and for the people that are in need, wherever they are. 19% of the RRRP, the Regional Resilience and Response Plan, has been funded so far. Only around, if we take the number of refugees accepted in or at least the pledged places, it's barely 8% of the refugees that are in Lebanon. So it's actually a very, very small amount. But we see what we see: tolerance to restrictive policies everywhere, and especially in Lebanon. I think the role of the West is actually to play a role in humanitarian access, whether to Syria or Lebanon, because trust me, in Lebanon, international agency workers are not given residency for more than three months, which is impossible for NGOs to be able to work and function with a strict minimum of residency permits. They are not able to actually have cabinet decisions to register NGOs as international NGOs. So basically, it's here. It's part of the role of the West. It's not just to accept refugees and pay the money they necessitate, but also to make sure that policies in the places where those vulnerable communities are, the policies are actually protecting them and not pushing them to actually joining the despot, or even in the case of Lebanon, where they are forced to sign voluntary pledges to go back to Syria or to go back to Iraq.
Thank you. Before,
if I may just say, I mean, that's why the solidarity is so important, that it currently is lacking on the part of Europe. I mean, it's the numbers that we're talking about are relatively low, are very low in comparison, but it's so important. And there I have to praise Germany and the German society. They have made places available. They are receiving refugees. We still have to see other major European countries to follow Germany's example. And it's, I mean, I'm European myself, and I'm sometimes ashamed to be European these days. So that's a very important step to do, solidarity. Turkey is showing the way at the moment in the way they receive Syrian refugees. They are allowed to work. The children can go to school. They have access to health facilities. That's an approach that we would like to see. Of course, in Lebanon and other countries as well. But we understand the pressures that are on Lebanon. But these are the things that we would like to see happen. Turkey, I mean, Germany on the one hand within Europe is a positive example. Turkey, in the way it receives Syrian refugees at the moment, is another positive example that needs emulation.
Actually, that was my last question going to Gabriel. Before we open this panel to your questions, I wanted to ask you about this European solidarity, how to create more responsibility. What are these local or this national governments being afraid of? I mean, are they really being afraid of this right-wing parties that gain at elections because they have these xenophobic programs? Are European citizens really so afraid of these refugees coming to Syria? It's really shameful. I mean, I have just examples from Great Britain. Great Britain has taken in some 4,000 Syrians. It's the third biggest economy inside Europe. And you ask yourself, or France. France is really very spoken out when it comes to political solutions, military assistance, and what have you. And they've taken some hundred Syrians. It's ridiculous. So how come? How can we create this? Yeah, more, as you just put it, more solidarity among the Europeans. Maybe Germany should, I don't know, push more their European neighbors. But what could be, what are your ideas, Gabriele?
Yes. Well, first of all, let me say that it is not the case just to speak about Germany or Italy or England. We are in Europe, it's a European problem, but also I agree with you, it's a problem of the international community. And I really see a lack of responsibility on the political level, both if you are talking about the Syrian crisis and the Syrian war, or about refugees. I mean, I would like to see our politicians to make their best efforts not to stop people, but to stop the war in Syria, which should be, maybe, I think, the best solution, because we are talking about people who are escaping from the war, and we are sitting here and we say, okay, the next 10 years probably the war will keep on, so we have to find a sustainable solution for the next 10 years. It's not the right approach. I mean, for at least for the politicians, for the governments, I mean, of the international community. It's not a problem of the West, of the region, the international community. Then back to the asylum, I just want to say two things. The first, please, let's try to deconstruct this myth of the invasion. We are not talking about the invasion. It's not that if you bring 5,000 people, 100,000 will arrive, and then 10 million, and then 1 billion. Until now, in Syria, you have, yes, we talked about the internally displaced people, but they are still in Syria. I mean, the only 4 million of Syrians, with such a big disaster, they left Syria. And the majority of them, they are still in Lebanon, in Jordan, in Turkey, not just because they are waiting for their settlement, but because they are waiting to go back their houses.
It's only 250,000 who came to Europe.
Yeah, 250,000. It's more or less the 2%. If you take the refugees and the IDPs.
5%, I think it's 5%.
5% of people chose Europe. So here we have two theories. There are some people who said, okay, only the 5% arrived because it's so dangerous. And so, you know, when you have to decide to take the boat and risk your life, only a few people are there, so brave. And so only 5% they have chosen Europe. I don't believe that theory. When you speak with the people who take the boat, they tell you, I'm not afraid to die. I survived the war. I passed so many checkpoints, the regime, the Daesh, the militias in the country. Why should I be afraid to take the sea? If I stay in Syria, I die. If I stay in another country, I don't see a future. So let me try. I do mean that if I think... at least let's try to experiment that. If we give people a legal alternative, I don't think that so much more people who choose Europe. Second point, there's a point of international rights. Asylum is a right, yes or not? If it is a right, we have to take our responsibilities. If we are a neighboring country like Lebanon, or if we are Japan, or Argentina, or Germany, it's not important. If asylum is a right, we are part of a community, and we have to grant asylum. I don't want to choose refugees. I don't want to be put in the situation to say, you can come, you cannot come. I want people to choose where they want to come, and I want international community to take its responsibility. And if the people who come, there are too many, and we don't want them, let's try to stop the war, which is, I think, the first point that we have to talk about. A very last point to finish. A very last point to finish, because if we talk about asylum, we cannot forget the mobility, the right of mobility. I come back to the issue of visa. If tomorrow the war explodes in Italy, let's Germany aside, if there is a war in Italy,
thank you.
Me, as an Italian, I am free to go almost all around the world. I don't need to apply for a settlement, I don't need to go to the UN, I don't need to be part of a program of a settlement of Germany. I can come to Berlin, to Buenos Aires, to Damascus, Beirut, or I don't know what. There is a problem of mobility. Asylum is once you arrived and you are recognized as a refugee and you get some rights. But there is a problem of mobility, and we have to choose on which side we want to stay, because there are thousands of people every week who are dying in the same islands where probably some of you will go for holidays this summer. So, I mean, it's our sea, it's our land, and we have to find a solution also to this. I don't want to keep on counting the death, you know, every day and make like if it was a problem of, I don't know, of money, of funds, integration, or I don't know what.
Thank you. By the way, the film that you just directed... it will be shown tomorrow here in the Heinrich Böll Foundation tomorrow evening at 8 o'clock for all the people who live in Berlin. Now, I want to open up this panel for questions. There is one gentleman right there with a beard over there. We will take 3 questions and then make a round of answers probably. Please, go ahead.
Guten Tag, hallo. Ich würde mich auf Deutsch äußern in der Hoffnung, dass ich... dass ich Sie anspreche, dass Sie mich zuhören, dass meine Worte hörbar sind oder so. Ich bin fast vor 3 Jahren aus Syrien geflüchtet.
Könnten Sie sich kurz vorstellen mit Namen?
Ja, mein Name ist Rahman Kalaf. Bin vor fast 3 Jahren aus Syrien geflüchtet. Und Ich habe so viele Fragen eigentlich, aber es geht nur mehr darum, dass...
Vielleicht die wichtigste zuerst?
Das Wichtigste ist, die Bundesaufnahmeprogramme, die Herrn Kloß so dargestellt hat, und dass wir unsere Verwandte holen können und so weiter. Das scheint so sehr großzügig, aber eigentlich, das war gar nicht so. Ich habe zum Beispiel versucht, dass ich meine Familie so nach Deutschland bringe, habe mich dann durch Hotline so angemeldet, und dann sagten sie mir, dass ich eine Verpflichtungserklärung vorlegen sollte. Das heißt, dass ich die Unterhaltskosten und so weiter alles das sichern konnte, und ich könnte nur eine Person von meiner Familie nachholen. Und stellen Sie sich vor, meine Damen und Herren, ich habe meinen Vater, meine Mutter und meine Schwester und meinen Bruder in Syrien. Und wir sollten dann uns entscheiden, wer am Leben bleiben wird. Es scheint für Sie, wenn ich das Verb sage, retten, es ist ein sehr häufig benutzter Verb, aber es ist retten. Und das war kein großzügiger Programm. Dann sollte ich mich wirklich von meinem kleinen Bruder. Wir haben uns dann für die 17-Jährige entschieden, dass er nach Deutschland kommt. Das ist das Erste. Und für mich ist es mehr als eine moralische Debatte, weil dass ich jetzt gerade hier stehe. Das sind die von außen auferlegten Umstände. Dass der Tod sich auf andere Fläche der Erde spiegelt, dass es keine politische Lösung gibt, weil seit 4 Jahren die Sura permanent, wir zeigen unseren Tod, und nur weil einige sich an die Macht festhalten, und die Westen, die haben gar nichts getan von Anfang an. Das war friedlich, das war super friedlich, das waren 9 Monate, die politische Lösung fehlt. Meine Frage wäre an Herrn Kloß: Es gibt in Deutschland jetzt mehr als 50.000 Syrer, die so wie ich ein gespaltenes Leben führen. Hier ist super, die Leute geht's wohl, und aber ich führe doch ein gespaltenes Leben. Ich muss irgendwie witzig sein, ich muss normal sein, aber meine Familie lebt in Syrien. Es kommen Monate, wo ich nicht weiß, ob sie am Leben sind oder nicht. Es gibt kein Netz, es gibt keinen Empfang.
Und was ist jetzt Ihre Frage nochmal konkret an Herrn
Kloß? Meine Frage ist, warum geben Sie die Syrer doch die Chance, dass sie die hier sind, die vielleicht ein bisschen gut integriert sind, wie Sie meinen? Warum geben Sie die Chance nicht, dass Sie Ihre Familie doch holen? Was meinen Sie damit vor Ort? Wir sind doch okay. Da.
Vielen Dank. Und ich glaube, die Frage ist angekommen. Es ging um die Verpflichtung. Das ist ein guter Punkt. Wir kommen darauf zurück. Wir sammeln jetzt noch 2 weitere Fragen. Und dann gehen wir aufs Panel. Da war da hinten noch die Dame, genau, mit den blonden Haaren. Und dann hier vorne noch die Dame. Und dann machen wir mal. Bitte aufstehen und einmal kurz vorstellen.
Ja, Ines Kappert von der Taz. Ich habe auch eine Frage an Herrn Kloß. Und zwar, Sie hatten vorhin kurz erwähnt, es gibt eben nur begrenzt Platz in Deutschland. Ich würde Ihnen da gerne widersprechen. Es gibt ein Beispiel, wo die Integration extrem gut geklappt hat. Das war bei den Russlanddeutschen. 2,5 Millionen Russlanddeutsche wurden hier integriert. Und zwar weitgehend unter dem Radar der Öffentlichkeit. Also man kann da sehen, Deutschland hat die ökonomische Kraft, wenn es den politischen Willen gibt, sehr, sehr viele Menschen aufzunehmen. Gleichzeitig sind wir eine alternde Gesellschaft. Es gibt Studien, die unter anderem von der Zentrale für politische Bildung verbreitet oder publiziert werden, dass in Deutschland pro Jahr 400, also dass Deutschland eine Migration von etwa 400 Personen pro Jahr braucht, um die 400.000, um den demografischen Wandel ausgleichen zu können, weil wir ja eben einfach eine überalterte Gesellschaft sind. Also angesichts dieser ganzen Zahlen, also der problemlosen Möglichkeit, ökonomischen Möglichkeit, 2,5 Millionen Russlanddeutsche in Deutsche zu integrieren, aufzunehmen, angesichts des demografischen Wandels, frage ich mich, woher die Zufriedenheit kommt mit den Zahlen, mit denen wir momentan hier zu tun haben.
Danke. Und noch die Damen hier vorne, bitte.
Ja, Christine Kamm, Abgeordnete im Bayerischen Landtag. Wir beschäftigen uns natürlich auch sehr viel mit dem Thema, oder ich jedenfalls, also die Mehrheitsfraktion noch nicht, mit dem Thema des Nachzugs von Familienangehörigen. Und soweit ich weiß, haben wir nur ungefähr ein Viertel bis ein Drittel der Anträge auf Familiennachzug der bei uns gut integrierten Syrer bisher über dieses Kontingent abgewickelt. Und meistens helfen ja die Angehörigen selber. Sie bürgen für ihre Angehörigen zum großen Teil, soweit sie es können. Und ich finde es wirklich ein Zeichen, was zumindest als Minimum hier ausgehen müsste, ist, dass diese Familiennachzugsgeschichten möglichst schnell abgewickelt werden müssen. Also das sollte einfach auch ein Signal aus dieser Tagung sein. Und das Zweite ist natürlich, die Flüchtlinge, die zu uns kommen, die anerkannt sind, die möchten natürlich auch gerne ihre Familien nachholen. Das dauert Monate, bis es Visa gibt. Warum geht es nicht schneller, Herr Kloß?
Ja, das waren jetzt drei Fragen, die sich nun alle, Sie müssen jetzt hier als Stellvertreter der Bundesregierung alle diese Fragen beantworten, das tut mir leid. Aber das Problem der Verpflichtungserklärung ist tatsächlich ein großes, weil eben viele Syrer inzwischen Familie geholt haben, aber nicht auf Jahre für diese bürgen können. Das übersteigt selbst das Budget eines Arztes oder eines Ingenieurs hier in Deutschland.
Das muss Ihnen gar nicht leid tun, weil das ist mein Beruf und ich kann das auch gut vertreten. Und auf Ihre Frage hin, wir haben einen Unterschied zwischen dem Bundesaufnahmeprogramm und dem Landesaufnahmeprogramm. Bei dem Bundesaufnahmeprogramm spielt die Verpflichtungserklärung nur in einem Bundesland eine Rolle. Das ist Ihr Bundesland, Bayern. Das hat ganz spezifische Gründe, weil dort eine Vorauswahl genommen wurde, dass nur Menschen mit Verpflichtungserklärung am Bundesaufnahmeprogramm teilnehmen können. Das hat der Bund nicht entschieden. Der Bund hat die Wünsche auf Verwandtenaufnahme der Länder übernommen und eine bestimmte Quote innerhalb des Bundesaufnahmeprogramms über die Verwandtenaufnahme gemacht. Aber ansonsten spielt im Bundesaufnahmeprogramm die Verpflichtungserklärung keine Rolle. Ganz anders sieht die Situation aus bei den Landesaufnahmeprogrammen. Die Landesaufnahmeprogramme haben 15 Bundesländer, Bayern ist nicht dabei. Und in der Tat, von Anfang an haben die Bundesländer aus fiskalischen Gründen darauf bestanden, dass bei den Landesaufnahmeprogrammen in der Tat ein reines Sponsormodell zur Anwendung kommen soll. Dergestalt, dass wie in Ihrem Fall dann die Verwandten Verpflichtungserklärungen abgeben müssen, also die volle Haftung für den Aufenthalt dann übernehmen müssen. Der Krieg dauert länger, als wir alle erwartet haben. Also will ich jetzt nicht so ein Länderbashing hier betreiben, aber man musste schon bewusst sein, auch vor 2 Jahren, dass natürlich der Moment kommen würde, wo man fragt, wie lange sollen die Verpflichtungserklärungen denn gehen? Der Bund hat das nicht so, der Bund musste das Einvernehmen erteilen. Wir hätten auch ein Einvernehmen erteilt für Landesaufnahmeprogramme ohne Verpflichtungserklärung. Es ist eine reine haushalterische Entscheidung der jeweiligen Länder. Die Länder sind frei, auch heute die Landesaufnahmeanordnung so wie die Bundesaufnahmeanordnung zu gestalten oder vielmehr auch die Verpflichtungsgeber aus der Verpflichtung zu entlassen. Zum Teil haben sie das getan. Im vergangenen Sommer hat die IMK beschlossen, dass zumindest die Gesundheitskosten übernommen werden seitens der Landeshaushalte. Ich weiß aber auch, dass nicht alle Bundesländer dies gemacht haben. Ich hoffe, ich habe damit Ihre Frage beantwortet. Es ist unbefriedigend, ja. Es ist eine Möglichkeit der Länder gewesen, so will ich es überhaupt nicht kritisieren, für Menschen, die eben die Möglichkeit haben, eine derartige Verpflichtungserklärung abzugeben, ein Sponsor zu sein, Verwandte nach Deutschland zu holen. Eine ganz andere Frage, das ist das, was Sie angesprochen haben, ist die der Familienzusammenführung. Das ist ein Rechtsanspruch, der wächst insbesondere dann, wenn man hier als Flüchtling anerkannt wird. Und mittlerweile ist es so, dass wir syrische Flüchtlinge bzw. syrische Asylbewerber in einem Schnellverfahren anerkennen, zu einem nahezu 100%. Und damit entsteht mit Anerkennung, also innerhalb weniger Tage, wird sich bemüht darum, die Anerkennung hinzubekommen. Und dann entsteht daraus dann eben ein Anspruch auf Familiennachzug. Innerhalb der Bundesregierung, Das Auswärtige Amt gemeinsam mit dem BMI bemüht sich nunmehr intensiv, in den Auslandsvertretungen die Infrastruktur so zu gestalten und die Verfahren so zu optimieren, dass es eben nicht zu solchen Wartezeiten kommt, wie Sie sie beschrieben haben, wie sie derzeit sind. Je nach Auslandsvertretung zwischen 6 und 8 Monate. Das ist einfach auch, es hängt nicht mit dem Willen zusammen. Die Menschen haben Anspruch darauf, auf Familiennachzug der Kernfamilie. Die Bundesregierung wird dem nachkommen. Wir versuchen schon, das Verfahren auch mit den Bundesländern zu optimieren, weil es müssen auch gewisse Zustimmungserfordernisse gibt es gegenüber den Ländern. Und insoweit müssen wir die Verfahren optimieren. Wir hoffen, dass wir durch entsprechende Skalierung der Kapazitäten, die allerdings, wer sich zum Beispiel in der Botschaft in Beirut auskennt, auch schon durch die Aufnahmeprogramme sehr limitiert sind. Wir bemühen uns darum, das schnellstmöglich abzuarbeiten. Ich weiß nicht, ob es ein Trost ist. Ich ruhe mich auch nicht auf den Zahlen aus. Es ist einfach so, es ist eine Herausforderung. In Schweden beispielsweise warten sie derzeit auf 18 Monate Familiennachzug. Da sind die schwedischen Kollegen auch nicht glücklich drüber. Aber es ist einfach auch eine Frage der Kapazitäten vor Ort, denn das muss auch ein geordneter Prozess sein bei der Familienzusammenführung. Letzte Frage da hinten von der Dame von der Taz. Sie machen einen Riesenfass auf, das ist die Zuwanderungsdebatte. Asylgewährung und Flucht ist nicht gleichbedeutend mit der Zuwanderungsdebatte. Wenn wir fragen nach dem Migrationsbedarf, den Deutschland hat, und nach den Antworten, die auf den demografischen Wandel zu geben sind, müssen, und das können sich Demografen unterhalten, angucken, welche inländischen Erwerbspersonenpotenziale sie erheben können. Das ist das allererste, weil sie mit Zuwanderung auf demografische Entwicklung nur äußerst begrenzt Einfluss nehmen können. Das ist rein zahlenmäßig so. Sie können die Jahrgangskohorten, die jährlich in den Ruhestand treten, nicht, das ist in der Breite auch jetzt durch die Absenkung des Renteneintrittsalters so ein auch Fachkräfteverlust, der durch Zuwanderung in dieser Schnelligkeit nicht ansatzweise ausgeglichen werden kann. Und wir dürfen uns eins nicht vormachen. Die Menschen, die kommen und hier gute Fluchtgründe haben, wie die syrischen Flüchtlinge, die wollen wir unserer humanitären Verantwortung folgend auch sehr gerne aufnehmen. Und wenn der Konflikt denn 10 Jahre dauern sollte, was er Gott behüte, nicht tun möge, dann müssen die Menschen sich hier und sollen sich auch schnellstmöglich hier in den Arbeitsmarkt integrieren. Und ich bin da auch nicht bang, viele werden das schaffen, aber es ist, und das muss man auch offen ansprechen, kein Prozess, der sich innerhalb weniger Wochen und Monate vollzieht, sondern hier kommen ganze Familien. Für die Kinder wird es sicherlich schneller möglich sein. Wir müssen aber den Menschen, die hier leben, auch sagen, dass das Prozesse sind, die mitunter auch eine ganze Generation dauern können. Das heißt, Asylbewerber oder vielmehr Flüchtlinge sind ist kein Fachkräftepool. Das sind Menschen, die wir aus humanitärer Verantwortung aufnehmen und die bewerten wir auch nicht nach Nützlichkeitserwägungen.
Ja, aber der Vergleich mit den Russlanddeutschen ist nur insofern interessant, als dass man dort gesehen hat, jede Gruppe, die ankommt und von vornherein das Recht zu arbeiten hat, die Russlanddeutschen hatten sofort einen deutschen Pass, integrieren sich natürlich umso schneller. Wenn ich Flüchtlinge erstmal in Heime sperre und dort warten sie auf einen Sozialarbeiter, der vielleicht alle 2 Wochen vorbeikommt, wo sie die Sprache nicht sprechen, nicht die richtige Begleitung haben, dann erschwert es natürlich die Integration dieser Menschen. Und deswegen wäre es eben sinnvoll, und es ist jetzt absehbar, was auf Deutschland oder was auf Europa zukommt, dort die Kapazitäten vielleicht auszuweiten und den Leuten eben, wie bei dem Bundesprogramm ja, mit einer Arbeitsgenehmigung die Möglichkeit zu geben, sehr früh die Sprache zu lernen, Sprachkurse zu finanzieren. Weil dann kommen viele der sehr gut ausgebildeten Syrer, das ist ja häufig auch Mittelstand, der hier ankommt, kommen wahrscheinlich sehr gut hier klar oder werden sich auch schnell integrieren.
Anerkannte Flüchtlinge haben von Anfang an das Recht auf Aufnahme einer Erwerbstätigkeit. Überhaupt dürfen Asylbewerber jetzt auch nach 3 Monaten bereits arbeiten. Es ist eben nicht die Frage der... Bitte? In der Theorie, woran liegt es denn? Das liegt an Sprachkenntnissen, wenn anerkannte Asylbewerber, wir gucken das jetzt auch mal an für Asylbewerber, also anerkannte Flüchtlinge, haben einen Anspruch auf Integrationskurs. Wir schauen uns das an für Asylbewerber mit einer gewissen Bleibperspektive, hier auch eine frühzeitige Sprachförderung hinzubekommen. Aber man darf sich auch nicht der Fehlvorstellung erliegen, dass hier zum Beispiel Entscheider des Bundesamtes sozusagen frei verfügbar und skalierbar sind. Gleiches gilt für die Einrichtung von Integrationskursen. Und last but not least, und ich muss es leider ansprechen, es ist auch immer eine Frage der finanziellen Unterlegung solcher Maßnahmen. Ich kann immer, es macht mir auch Spaß, ja, natürlich Programme auszurollen, von denen die Menschen profitieren. Aber das geht alles nur im Rahmen des Budgets.
Jetzt haben wir hier eine sehr deutsche Debatte. Gibt es noch Fragen, vielleicht internationalere? Da hinten, die Dame hat sich jetzt lange gemeldet mit dem Roten.
Thank you. I'm Ola Saleh from Syria. I'm one of those refugees, Mr. Klaus, you referred to from your country, from your neighboring country, sort of, Sweden. And I guess your speech about the refugees is highly charged with prejudices. I'm one of those refugees you're talking about that integrated immediately in the labor market in Sweden, even though before I learned the language. When I took my residence permit, please allow me to finish. When I took up my, yeah, I just saw you grabbing the microphone. When I took my residence permit, I immediately got a full-time job in Sweden. And I was too busy working on terrorism in the EU, actually, that I didn't have the time to learn the Swedish language. So I guess there is a fault in the way refugees are perceived in Europe. You do not look at us as a labor force. Do you have any studies that support your claims about the refugees as that they do not fulfill the skilled workers' need that we have in Germany, that you have in Germany, for example, or any other European country? I think refugees are treated with lots of prejudices, that they are incapable. They're coming seeking just refuge and shelter and food, which is not the case. Refugees have doctors, have professionals from different backgrounds, and we are not few in the refugee community, trust me. I guess it is high time that migration boards across Europe revise the way they perceive refugees. Thank you.
Thank you. Just collect. There was the gentleman there and the lady over there.
Yes, please go ahead.
Mein Name ist Cicuni. Ich arbeite in der Freiwilligen, ehrenamtlich in der Freiwilligen Flüchtlingshilfe. Die Frage besteht darin über die Sprachkurse. Und die Sprachkurse sind sowieso die erste Stufe der Integration und die wichtigste Stufe. Bis jetzt ist es so, dass die Flüchtlinge in Erstaufnahmelager kommen. In dieser Zeit besteht keine Möglichkeit, Deutsch zu lernen. Die Leute sitzen und warten 2 bis 9 Monate, bekommen Hilfe, Essen, Schlafen, alles etc. Also die Grundbedürfnisse werden sowohl gedeckt, aber an Integration wird gar nicht gedacht, ist nicht möglich, das kostet viel Geld und es gibt eine Menge Menschen, die freiwillig helfen und ehrenamtlich arbeiten, aber die Regierungen und die Landesregierungen kümmern sich kaum um diese Gruppen. Und deshalb ist es wichtig hier. Zweitens, es gibt viele Syrer, die Ärzte zum Beispiel sind und bereit sind, in Aufnahmelager umsonst zu arbeiten und Flüchtlinge medizinisch und Kinder zu versorgen. Diese Möglichkeit besteht auch nicht, obwohl wir uns bemüht haben, dass das passiert. Alle diese Probleme, die Deutschkurse zum Beispiel, nach 9 Monaten erst werden die Leute geschickt in die Privatschulen, die Volkshochschulen dürfen Deutschkurse erst anbieten, schon seit einem halben Jahr oder dreiviertel Jahr, weil die überlastet sind. Und die ehrenamtlichen Mitarbeiter in den Erstaufnahmelager haben keine Chance, dort mitzuwirken an diesem Problem, obwohl sie es wollen. Woran liegt das?
Okay, vielen Dank. Die Dame hier im blauen Pullover davor. Die hat
Herr
Entschuldige, Dangeleit, ich bin Ethnologin und Journalistin. Ich habe eine Frage.
Würden Sie bitte aufstehen, dann sieht man Sie besser.
Ja, ich habe eine Frage an Herrn Tenfeld und an Herrn Kloß. Und zwar, was mir so ein bisschen gefehlt hat in der ganzen Debatte jetzt, ist die Situation der Flüchtlinge im Norden Syriens, also in den kurdischen Gebieten, sprich in Rojava, Kamischlo, Kobane, Afrin, sind ja Flüchtlinge, die komplett isoliert sind von aller Hilfe, weil die Türkei die Grenzen dicht gemacht hat, weil eben von irakisch-Kurdistan die Grenzen dicht sind und von unten vom Islamischen Staat. Und da war die Frage, wie sieht's denn aus, überhaupt Möglichkeiten vom UNHCR da zu helfen an der Stelle? Und die andere Frage an Sie, Herr Kloß, ist, wieso engagiert sich die Bundesregierung eigentlich nicht, den NATO-Partner Türkei dahin zu bewegen, eben die Grenzen für einen Hilfskorridor für Kobane aufzumachen, damit die Flüchtlinge aus der Türkei wieder zurück können nach Kobane und beim Wiederaufbau ihrer Stadt mithelfen können? Danke.
Vielen Dank. Das Thema hatten wir ja vorhin schon mal kurz. Wir gehen in die Beantwortung. Und Herr Rahle wollte, glaube ich, was zu der Dame sagen, zu der Syrerin, die sich aus Schweden gemeldet hat vorhin für die erste Antwort.
Okay. I just wanted to add on something Ola said to in this case a German official. But I would second what she said to even Jordanian and Lebanese and Iraqis and Egyptian officials. Is that actually yes, Syrians are refugees and are also they have their own skills. They have their own doctors. They have their own engineers. They have their own teachers, which brings me to the doctors and teachers in particular. And it, well, basically, Lebanon takes a reason why we shouldn't provide education for Syrian refugees is because, well, the Lebanese teachers are overwhelmed. Well, yeah, but they have their own teachers. We can get their own teacher to teach the Syrian children. The same for doctors. Well, Lebanese doctors are overwhelmed. Yeah, but you can bring those doctors that are refugees and make them their doctors. So I would like to generalize what you said and bring in all over where refugees, not just Syrian refugees are, but all refugees are. We always try to forget their profile and we always try to coin them as refugees without actually giving them a name, a reference, a job description, or what they can do actually to benefit their own communities.
Thank you.
I mean, I would feel entirely misunderstood if you get the impression that I underestimate the potential of Syrian refugees or refugees of other ethnicity or origin. This was not my point. I mean, I'm in particular for the Syrian refugees in Germany, as I've already said, they are far above average educated, and I'm very optimistic with regard to the integration of these people into German society. But this is not, I don't want to make the potential as a precondition for the residents if it comes to refugee admission. This was my point. It's not the reason for privilegiation for refugees if they can contribute as an added value to the host society. This is our humanitarian responsibility to grant refuge, and I'm happy if the refugees actually contribute to the host society and are not dependent on social benefits, because this is the best, because this opens up new resources for other refugees which we might take up. So it's not about labor migration and refugees. So I'm happy for the integration of refugees into the German labor market as soon as possible, and we try to promote this with the integration courses, and as I've said, recognized refugees have a right to these integration courses. Having said that, it's also true that other refugees have not the capacity or are a bit older, do not catch the language as quickly as you did. Well, it's okay. That's another point. That's another point. The Swedish labor market might also differ to Germany. I would say the vast majority of labor here, jobs in Germany, you would require German as a language. Of course, there are companies where you have actually English as a common language, and you can actually work in English. But this is rather the exception in Germany. I don't know the situation in Sweden. What I can talk about Sweden is they have a study on integration of refugees into the labor market, and they had an intensive program of promoting refugees into the labor markets. And after two language courses and vocational training and so on and so forth, and after 2 years, I mean, it's a Swedish study, yeah? After 2 years, about 25% of the refugees have actually integrated into the labor market, which also means that 75% did not. It just illustrates that it might take longer than expected. But of course, refugees have a potential. We have to do the utmost to integrate these people, but it might take time and money. I mean, my son is German-born. He is now going to the school, and it will take 12 years in school plus, I don't know, 3-4 years at the university. So just count. This is also an investment of training into my son, which does the state provide. You cannot expect that people can from scratch integrate into the labor market. It takes time, and it has to be outspoken that this might cost money. I mean, we have to create willingness that this money is spent, but it would be an illusion to say that refugees can be integrated immediately, in particular if you have a working environment like in Germany.
There was one question about Kurdistan, Iraq, yes. Rojava, Kurdistan, yeah. Syria, Kurdistan.
I mean, there the answer is I'm afraid I don't know the detailed situation in northern Syria. But as I mentioned earlier, I mean, there are more than 4 million Syrians inside Syria that we have trouble reaching. I imagine that this is one of the areas where we simply, as the UN, have trouble getting access and be able to assist. But I'm afraid I don't have the detailed knowledge of that area.
And why not influencing the Turkish government to open access to Kobani? That was one question as well.
Das ist richtig. Zunächst einmal, hier ist es auch schon genannt worden, die türkische Regierung tut wirklich sehr viel für die Flüchtlinge, für eine gute Aufnahme und Integration. Und von dem her steht es mir jetzt auch nicht an, hier Kritik zu üben. Und soweit die deutsche Regierung dann Einfluss nehmen kann, und der Einfluss dürfte auch begrenzt sein, wird sie dies tun über die geeigneten Kanäle.
Jetzt machen wir noch eine Runde. Von der Seite hier drüben hatten wir, glaube ich, noch. Da hinten hatte sich noch jemand gemeldet. Moment mal, ganz kurz da hinten. Ja, die Dame hatte vorhin schon gewinkt. Moment, da ist eine winkende Frau. Und Lula dort hinten. Und Moment, da war irgendjemand, hatte sie. Ja, das stimmt, aber Sie hatten vorhin schon eine Frage gestellt. Jetzt wollte ich gerne jemanden dran nehmen, der noch nicht gesagt hat. Er hat schon gefragt. Ist nicht beantwortet worden. Ja, da haben Sie übrigens recht. Stimmt, Herr Kloß. Da war noch eine Frage wegen, warum das so lange dauert mit den Integrationskursen in den Aufnahmelagern. Ne? Und dass die Leute dort bis zu 9 Monate sitzen, ohne irgendwie integriert zu werden. Ja.
Was die Integration. Wir müssen auch hier wieder differenzieren, natürlich zwischen den Menschen, die zu uns kommen. Und wir haben momentan eine große Herausforderung im Asylsystem. Das hängt noch nicht mal so mit Syrien zusammen. Wenngleich natürlich viele Syrer zu uns kommen, aber wir haben ungefähr die Hälfte aller Asylbewerber, und wir müssen bis zu über 400.000 Asylbewerber dieses Jahr gewärtigen. Wie gesagt, über eine Hälfte von denen kommt aus Ländern des Westbalkans, wo wir nicht die Situation, eine Flüchtlingssituation haben oder eine Vertreibungssituation. Lebensverhältnisse mögen schwierig sein, aber politische Verfolgung findet dort quasi nicht statt. Und trotzdem haben diese Menschen einen Anspruch auf ein Verfahren hier in Deutschland. Wir versuchen, die Infrastruktur dafür hinzustellen. Das geht auf Kosten insbesondere anderer Flüchtlingsgruppen, das ist ganz klar. Nicht unbedingt der Syrer hier, die haben wir auch ausgeklinkt aus dem Normalverfahren, genauso wie die Iraker, weil wir hier eine extrem hohe Anerkennungsquote haben. Wir erkennen, oder unser Anspruch ist es, dass wir innerhalb von 2 Wochen nach Asylantragstellung den positiven Bescheid bei syrischen Flüchtlingen dann zustellen können. Danach entsteht der Anspruch auf Integrationskurse. Gleiches versuchen wir bei den Ländern von Westbalkanstaaten, dass wir priorisieren und die auch schnellstmöglich ablehnen. Und es ist aber alles natürlich eine exponentielle Steigerung der Asylbewerberzahlen. Vor 2 Jahren knapp 130.000, vergangenes Jahr etwas über 200.000 und nochmal eine Verdopplung auf vielleicht mehr als 400.000. Das müssen wir erstmal auch abbilden in der ganzen Infrastruktur der Unterstützung für Flüchtlinge.
Die Dame da hinten.
اسمي كريم رشكو انا من سوريا انا حابه استفسر عن اللاجئين السوريين القادمين من بلغاريا وباسمين ببلغاريا او عندهم اقامه قبل عام او اكثر كان الوضع
just a second for the translation.
Okay. اسمي كريمة رشكو أنا من سوريا أنا حابة استفسر عن اللاجئين السوريين القادمين من بلغاريا باسمين ببلغاريا أو معهم إقامة بلغارية قبل عام وأكثر كان الوضع طبيعي جدا ويحصلون على الإقامة الألمانية هون من 3 شهور ولا قدام يتم رفض إعطائهم الإقامة الألمانية ويتم تسفيرهم آخر حالة قبل 3 أيام تم الهجوم على عائلة سورية يمكن بدورتموند وأخذهم مباشرة إلى المطار الزوجة أصابها حالة من الجنون لحتى توقف البوليس وما رجعوا لبلغاريا رغم أنه أنتم بتعرفوا أنه معاملة الحكومة البلغارية سيئة جدا جدا مثل معاملة النظام السوري مع السوريين واللاجئين من الضرب ومن الاعتقال لا تتوفر هناك يعني سبل معيشية في بلغاريا أنتم تقولون أننا نحاول أن نوسع برنامج جلب اللاجئين السوريين إلى ألمانيا لمنحهم الإقامة طيب عندكم لاجئين سوريين ليش عم بتعيدوهم لبلغاريا؟ الوضع مزري جدا ما دام هن هون على ارضكم ما بتحتاجوا لتوسيع برنامج لتقولوا هالكلام ممكن توضيح في حالات كثيره كثيره هون من الشباب ومن البنات ومن العائلات شكرا
شكرا اوكي ثانك يو ذس از ذا كويستشن اوف دبلن اند ذيز لوز رولا اسد اوفر ذير
يا كريستين اي دونت هاف ا كويستشن بات ماي فريند رولا نوت ساتيسفايد وذ ذا انسر سو اي ويل جيف ماي تيرن تو هير تو نوت بي اغنورد ليتر
Okay, well, I would like to thank you for your generosity listening and for taking actually the time to be with us here and bearing with all our, you know, challenges, Mr. Klaus. Definitely, I appreciate that. But just to go back to your point about the introduction to the labor market program in Sweden, that could be debated forever. And one point, I did not get my job through that program. I got my job immediately outside the Arbetsförmedlingen or the Employment Office program. And on this point specifically, the Employment Office, which is my point, and I'm not speaking about Syrian refugees as we're more educated than other refugees. I'm speaking about refugees in general. I've worked for UNHCR in Syria with Iraqi refugees. There are highly educated Iraqis who Syria has missed lots of chances to mobilize them and to make use of their professionality. So
I think you made your point already, didn't you? Yeah, I mean, it was very welcome. It was even, taken and introduced, Yanni, to the countries of the region as well. He just agreed to you and said Lebanon and other countries should do that.
I don't think I am. I'm challenging anyone here, but I'm just trying to highlight a point on the employment program in Sweden. It's not the way refugees actually, it's not that why refugees get easier to the labor market in Sweden. And I want just to add with a last sentence on this point, that is the employment office in Sweden actually offers refugees, regardless of your professional background, cleaning jobs, cooking jobs, driving jobs. That is the introduction to the Swedish labor market program in Sweden.
Okay, thank you. We have 2 more. There was one... here in the front and over there for us. And the lady over there, because we're... Okay, you...
Okay. Genau, ich spreche jetzt mal auf Deutsch. Ich habe noch 2 Fragen. Die erste Frage zu der Familienzusammenführung. Sie haben ja gesagt, dass genau wie für Deutsche ist es im Gesetz nicht, aber wenn ein Syrer hier zum Beispiel seine Ehefrau aus Syrien holen will, hat er eigentlich theoretisch das Recht dazu. Aber die Länder haben das jetzt so geregelt, dass sie... oder die handhaben das so, dass sie abgesichert sein müssen, dass diese Person von ihrer Ehepartner den Aufenthalt finanzieren kann. Kann nicht die Bundesebene auf die Länder einwirken? Ich meine, es gibt ja auch eine Rahmengesetzgebung und sie dazu anhalten, dass sie das nicht nur an finanzielle Kriterien binden, diese Entscheidung über die Familienzusammenführung zum Beispiel oder über den Familiennachzug. Und die zweite Frage zum Arbeitsrecht. Es gab ja die Asylrechtsreform, ich glaube, das ist ja schon fast 8 Monate her, dass in der Theorie Flüchtlinge das Arbeitsrecht bekommen können. Wann wird das denn umgesetzt? Weil ich kenne, also ich bin freie Journalistin und arbeite auch mit Flüchtlingen. Ich kenne, glaube ich, über 500 Flüchtlinge in den letzten 2 Jahren kennengelernt und ich kenne 3 davon, die Arbeitsrecht haben. Deswegen frage ich mich, wann wird das denn umgesetzt, dieses neue Recht auf Arbeit?
Bisschen was durcheinander. Aber jetzt sammeln wir erstmal noch 2 weitere Fragen hier. Hier vor. 1, 2. Ja, ich merke es nicht.
Ich schreibe das ein bisschen. Oh, I still am a veteran opponent in Syria. Actually, one info for Mr. Kloss. Maybe 30% or 50% of those people who claim to be a Syrian refugee, they are not a Syrian. And I think with some procedures, you can check about that and restudy these cases. And this will give you, actually many of them came from Lebanon, Iraq, Egypt, actually from these countries which its government is emulating the Syrian refugee, and those people claim to be Syrian, they are having the refugee asylum as a Syrian. And I think this will help you to extend this program of the Syrian, because they deserve this chance. Last point and second point. This is about, I heard something about how shame that kids don't go to the school. How shame as for the kid to be killed in bombarding by the regime in the liberated area inside his school. This is the most shameful. Before 3 years, everybody was asking for the no-fly zones and safe zones for the Syrian. The international community, especially the leaders by the American, actually, they refused to do that because they were afraid that this will help the rebels and the opposition against the regime. They don't want the regime to. They don't want them to use this advantage against the regime. Now, the north and the south, the most of this area have been liberated. The regime, I'm not talking about the ISIS area that controlled by the ISIS. No, about the south and the north. And I think without, in few months, all this area will be liberated. Why don't we have no fly zone on the safe area? And in this case, believe me, 80 or 90% of the refugee problem in Europe will be solved. Because we can rehabilitate those people, we will allow the moderate opposition to establish a service and administration in this area to rehabilitate those people inside Syria, in the north and in the west, and the neighborhood countries like Lebanon, for example, can be live arrest with his inside political sectarian problems to keep fighting together for the another 1 or 2 decades, like they have been done since 50 years. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Fawaz. This is where we started in the morning, actually, with Frederick Hoff and his, idea of safe zones and other engagement. Petra, you had 1 more question here.
My name is Petra Steenen. I know there are zillion of problems to be discussed, which are much bigger than the one I'm going to bring up now. But the one I'm bringing up now is an essential problem for human rights activists, civil society activists, and it's called papers. Passports and papers. And I feel, I'm looking around the table here, I think there are so many people here, maybe there is a report that has looked into the issue of papers of people within the Arab region. Visas, I mean, passports, Syrian passports are expiring. This means that people can't travel anymore, that we will not be able to hear the voices of the people we should hear, besides the ones of the jihadis and who have you. So my question is twofold. Is there information? I have access to people in the European Parliament. I'm becoming a little bit activist on this moment because we can discuss this, but this is something we might do something about altogether in the whole of Europe, because we need those voices in our debate. So question one, is there anybody in this audience, please come afterwards in the break, who has real technical information on what's happening on papers within Europe and within the region? There are I heard there are 50,000 babies being born in Lebanon without any identification paper. And the second is, and I'm looking at the panel, what could we do to actually make this more visible also within the political arena in Europe, that this is an issue? And I'm looking at my friend here. I had a third question, and I'll give it to her.
Thank you. Thank you. My name is Jasna Zajcik, former Mideast reporter, freelance journalist, now became activist and public relations professional for an NGO, which I founded myself. But I just have one question for Gabriele, if we can talk about Riace later on, and if this would be an idea to inform the gentleman here that the Città Futura could be an idea to save the German, dying little areas, and if we just can have a coffee, because I wanted to speak more, but now.
Okay. Now let's start with the question of the Familien auf Deutsch. Die Frage mit dem Familiennachzug, da ging, glaube ich, was durcheinander. Einerseits das Recht auf Familiennachzug und die Frage der Verpflichtungserklärungen. Das war die Dame hier. Wollen Sie dazu erst kurz darauf eingehen? Das ist, glaube ich, schnell erklärt. Und eben die Frage mit dem Arbeitsrecht, das kriegen ja anerkannte Asylbewerber.
Was jetzt die Verpflichtungserklärung angeht, also das gibt es, die Lebensunterhaltssicherung gibt es für anerkannte Flüchtlinge in den ersten 3 Monaten nach Anerkennung nicht, mit anderen Worten. Unabhängig von der Frage der Lebensunterhaltssicherung besteht ein Recht auf den Nachzug der Kernfamilie für anerkannte Flüchtlinge, wenn die Anerkennung sozusagen unmittelbar erfolgt ist. Das hängt damit zusammen, dass man sagt, wer sozusagen gekommen ist, anerkannt wird als Flüchtling, der will in der Regel auch mit seiner Familie zusammenleben und das soll er auch uneingeschränkt tun. Und deswegen kann man das nicht abhängig machen von der Lebensunterhaltssicherung. Das ist Ihre Fallgestaltung nur denkbar für Menschen, die sozusagen mehr als 3 Monate gewartet haben nach einer Asylanerkennung und dann um den Nachzug beantragen. Dann in der Tat besteht die Regelerteilungsvoraussetzung, von dem man auch absehen kann, dass man den Lebensunterhalt sichert. Für die ganzen syrischen Flüchtlinge, die jetzt hier anerkannt werden, gibt es das Recht, unabhängig von einer Lebensunterhaltssicherung. Man kann die auch nicht erwarten, und das führt mich gleich zum zweiten Thema, dass diese Menschen gleich, außer sie sind so besonders qualifiziert wie die andere Dame dort hinten, also es ist eher der Ausnahmefall, dass die Menschen gleich arbeiten können, für sich selbst aufkommen können. Und von dem her hat man das abgesehen. Das Rechtsstellungsverbesserungsgesetz ist in Kraft und das Recht auf Erwerbstätigkeit gibt es für diese Menschen, aber es muss immer auch einen Arbeitgeber geben, der bereit ist, Asylbewerber einzustellen. Es ist keine aufenthaltsrechtliche Frage mehr oder arbeitsrechtliche Frage. Nach drei Monate Aufenthalt dürfen Asylbewerber hier in Deutschland arbeiten. Dann habe ich noch die Frage da hinten gehabt zum Thema Dublin und Bulgarien. Wir haben ein gemeinsames europäisches Asylsystem. Und natürlich den Anspruch, dass unsere europäischen Partner auch ihren Verpflichtungen nachkommen. Es gibt gemeinsame Regeln in Europa für die Aufnahme von Asylbewerbern, die Unterbringung. Und das muss natürlich menschenwürdige Unterkünfte und Unterbringung geben, auch in Bulgarien. Es gilt für alle Länder der Europäischen Union, weil das ist die Grundvoraussetzung für das Dublin III-Verteilungsverfahren. Wir haben einen Asylzuständigkeitsmechanismus innerhalb der Europäischen Union. Es ist die europäische Solidarität ist schon genannt worden, ein Solidarverbund, wo wir davon ausgehen, dass jeder seine Verantwortung trägt und den Menschen, den Flüchtlingen ein lebenswürdiges Umfeld gibt. Natürlich gibt es auch für syrische Flüchtlinge, die in Bulgarien anerkannt werden, die Möglichkeit, besuchsweise für 3 Monate innerhalb eines halben Jahres sich auch hier aufzuhalten, wenn sie ihren eigenen Lebensunterhalt verdienen können. Aber es gibt keine Möglichkeit, sozusagen das Asylland zu wechseln. Eine freie Wahl des Landes, in dem man Schutz bekommt, gibt es nicht, sondern es gibt hier einen europäischen Solidarverbund, dem wir uns auch weiterhin verpflichtet sehen. And if I would like to continue, because this was addressed to me, the second question of our Swedish refugee here. Actually, I'm not quite sure whether you're, I mean, the refugee, you could actually come under different labels, also to Germany, if I may say so. And actually, these, I'm also in charge of labor migration in Germany. So you could also fulfill, and this is also open to all other refugees in the world, also to Syrians or Iraqis. We have a fairly open immigration law now, and for qualified workers, it's fairly easy, in particular for academics, to come to Germany and receive a blue card and to work here in Germany. Though this does not require that you are politically persecuted. So it's just a question of qualification. This is what I said. This depends then on other factors, on other criteria. And here, of course, everybody is welcome to contribute to the labor market here.
Maybe, Mr. Tenfeld, you want to answer this question about the papers? Because, I mean, it's really, we have tens of thousands of babies are being born until now in these refugee camps without papers because the parents have fled without the necessary papers. And this is a second lost generation. I mean, we already have the lost generations that's not attending schools. Now they are born without papers.
I mean, it's certainly a concern on the part of UNHCR to ensure that each and every person, refugee, child, is registered also in the camps. And I'm sure it's one of the issues that in Lebanon we are pursuing with the authorities. I mean, part of our mandate is as well to avoid statelessness so that people end up without any identity. But again, I'm not sure what the exact situation is in Lebanon with the registration, but it's certainly something, and maybe our colleague from Lebanon knows the details, but it's certainly something that's always, if not number one, very high on our list of things that we try to ensure is in place, that a person has an identity here within. I mean, your question was also about papers here within Europe, is it? But then it's, I guess, that it's really with the national governments who have also an interest to register. And who would usually issue some kind of registration, some kind of paper. So I'm not sure I understand what the problem is within Europe.
I mean, this brings me back to the Palestinian issue because the UNRWA stepped in this particular issue in giving papers to Palestinian refugees because they didn't have a government, and the Syrian government fails in providing Syrians now with papers. And the
Palestinian is a well-known and old issue about nationality, statelessness. I mean, in many statistics, they appear as stateless. It's one of the groups where we try to promote that identity is accorded, but it's at the end of the day in the hands of the host government.
Yes, now Mr. Ali wanted to contribute.
Well, I just want to discuss the issue of papers in general, in Lebanon in particular. In 2014, there were 73% of the births were unregistered, which is a very high amount. And this is actually what UNICEF has been able to actually gather. That's not what's happening also beyond the radar of UNICEF. But I can say 2015 onwards, the prospects are going to be much higher. I don't see the numbers decreasing. We're witnessing an increase in unregistered wedlocks, in weddings, in unregistered... Well, basically, all forms of paperwork, either with the Syrian government through the embassy or with the Lebanese government, require a residency. And basically, the Lebanese government is linking everything to the residency. So in that case, in an inability to move, in an inability to present those paperwork, inability to acquire those paperwork due to the lack of residency, we're going to witness an increase in those figures and an increase in statelessness. And if you're going to discuss later on the end of the conflict, the return and reintegration back in the territory, this question is going to be more and more difficult. What can we do about that? The Lebanese government is still stubbornly discussing residency permits without actually providing any form of solutions without the residency. birth rates, the parents have to have, well, birth, in order to register a birth certificate, both parents have to be registered. So basically it's even counterproductive, because on the long run, if now the Lebanese government considered that the Syrian refugee crisis is a security threat, by not encouraging Syrians to register their weddings, to register their birth, they're not acquiring paperwork from the Syrian embassy, etc., it's going to increase the security perception of Lebanese. I would just like to finish in a small comment, because I noticed that the discussion is, consider me pragmatic, inhumane, I don't know what, but it's we're discussing a lot about how to increase refugees and how to bring maybe more space for refugees, which is certainly acceptable, but I it's acceptable, but I think we should maybe discuss also how to solve the root causes that are leading to those people to ask for refugees and in need of international protection. We have to see.
We discussed this in two different panels. So
yes, but we didn't discuss.
Now we focus on the refugees.
We didn't discuss IDPs and what IDPs in Syria are witnessing, and with the inability to find a proper space, or because basically, in Lebanon, most refugees are now IDPs, with savings depleted, with situation more at risk. And if now UNHCR can say, I guess 5% of refugees are in extreme need of resettlement, these numbers are going to increase a year after a year. And IDPs are not protected. And we need to see, it's not just solving the conflict, we should discuss that in the morning, but even humanitarian access to provide safety for citizens. And maybe we shouldn't be afraid of maybe a no-fly zone, or even force Turkey, Lebanon, and Iraq, and Jordan to start passing humanitarian convoy. Because in Lebanon, there's no humanitarian convoy going through Lebanon. But I guess we need to put pressure on the Lebanese government for that.
Thank you. The last word is to Gabriele, who can answer to the lady here.
Yes, I'm going to answer. If I can, I would like also to add a very short comment. Because the problem of papers is not just for the Syrians who left the country, but also inside Syria. I mean, Europe and other countries recognize the rights of family reunification, but very often the case is that you are missing a paper, and you are not able to go to the municipality to ask for that paper. I mean, in Aleppo, the building of the municipality, on the roof there are snipers. I mean, there is a war zone. I mean, you cannot simply go and ask for your paper. Or maybe your son has been born in Syria and he was not registered. And so it's not only in third country. Also in Syria you have this problem. Second problem, sometimes you have the right of family reunification, but who is the family? Well, last time I was in Oslo, I met a Syrian director. He's living in Oslo with his sister. The sister lives in Oslo since many years as a job, even before the war. I mean, she has nothing to see with the war. And his brother is living with her in her house without documents. And he's not going to apply for asylum, because if he applies for asylum, he's going to send back to Bulgaria, because he was fingerprinted in Bulgaria. So he was not able to make family reunification, because a sister and a brother is not in our family, I don't know why. He came with the smugglers, entered in Bulgaria to go back to the Dublin problem, and he was fingerprinted. This is the Dublin Convention, I think it's a big problem. It's also related to what the girl from Sweden was saying before, I think, because we are not able to imagine I would like to use this word, liberalization of mobility for these people. You know what I mean? As a refugee, you got, according to the international rights, but also to the national rights, you get all the rights as a citizen, apart from the election. But actually, it's not that true, because me as an Italian citizen, for example, I get the right also to move inside Europe, to circulate. So the freedom of circulation inside Europe is not a right for a refugee. I mean, you can move, okay, for a visit, for tourism, but you cannot choose the country where you find a job. I mean, you have to walk on the track that the welfare state decided for you. I mean, it's not that easy. I mean, when you are fingerprinted in Bulgaria, you have to stay in Bulgaria. Your sister is in Norway, she has a house, she has maybe a job for you, but you should be in Bulgaria. So we don't have actually a European joint shared system of asylum. It would be very simple, but there is a cultural effort to recognize the dignity to the people as a citizen, as a subject, as a human being. You are free to choose what is the best for you. I mean, why we cannot talk about European asylum? You get your paper in Bulgaria, in Italy, or in Germany, and then you do what you do, what you want of your life, as I do, as you do, as we in Europe do. I mean, why we cannot recognize that that right? I think this is part of the problem. The problem is not that you are a refugee. The problem is that you come from the wrong side of our imaginary. I don't want to say of the world, because I mean, this is the land of the enemy. I mean, we can start talking about the Crusades. We can start talking about all the wars of the last decades of terrorism and whatever. I mean, there is a willingness problem. We should be. I mean, just. Sorry, too long. Make it brief. I mean, we're talking about Syrian refugees, and the main topic is the integration. I think it's a bit strange. I mean, we're talking about a disaster in Syria. About, I mean, from the human point of view, it's the hell. And we are here just talking about the process of integration. Why? Because the debate or the public opinion is focused on this. I mean, we are afraid of these people. If they were Brazilian or Spanish or, I don't know, Americans, maybe we would be happy with that. We would be proud. And to bring 5,000 more, 10,000 more. So now I go to the question. Sorry, Riace, very shortly. Riace was a project in the south of Italy. I'm going to be very, very short. It was a small village in the south of Italy, in a very depressed area. I'm talking about the economy. And so it was almost an empty village, because all the people from the village, they left, you know, during the Italian migration from the southern countryside to the north industrialized region. So the mayor of this village, once there was a migrant boat arrived just in front of the hill of the village on the sea, and he decided, okay, we can open the house and we can bring these people in our village, because the village is empty. So he just called the families of these private houses, and they gave him the keys, and he opened the village to these people. It was very interesting from the solidarity point of view, even as an experience for the citizens of the village. But if you want, at the end, and when you see it after 2 or 3 years, almost everybody, they left the village, of course, because the problem is that, and here I came to the main point, I mean, your integration, I hate this word, but your integration is made by the job opportunities at the very end, or by your relationships, the families, the friends, or the language, you know. I mean, there are many, many factors that make you decide to stay in one place. So these people were hosted for several months in these villages. And then at the end, almost everybody, they just left. And they went where they found an opportunity. I mean, it's, at the end, it's the job that gives you the dignity, not the possibility to organize your life. But it is still an experience in Italy. And I mean, this is seen also a very positive example of how even normal people, families, but not just the institutions, it's not just the problem of the institutions, of the government. We all can do something in our life.
Thank you very much, Gabriele, for bringing us back to this human approach to the whole problem. I thank my four guests here. There's a lot to be done. Humanitarian access in Syria, European laws, more solidarity from each one of us. Thank you very much for your attention. I still remind you once again on the evaluation forms in your sheets, and have a good afternoon. Thank you very much. Thank you.